Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome in to the Lakers Nation post-game show. We're breaking down the Lakers' unfortunate loss to the Indiana Pacers. We'll talk all about it. My name's Trevor Lane, senior writer for LakersNation.com. Today's show brought to you by Uptime Energy Drinks, how energy should feel. Find them at 7-Eleven, GNC, and Amazon.com. Lakers roll into Indiana shorthanded. We're going to break everything down. Joining me tonight is Jas Kang and Chris, the Masterpiece Masters. Guys, tough one, but we could kind of feel this one coming. Jas, what did you think about what we saw tonight from the Lakers?
I love the effort from the team. Playing shorthanded without two of your best three offensive players, obviously with Kuz being out and then AD now, with a bit of a sore ankle. Like Dwight Howard, look what he did out there. Avery Bradley, 13 points. Alex Caruso, 11 points. They were right there. What cost them this game, I think if you just look at the numbers, free throw shooting. You can't lose. You can't shoot 8 of 17 at 47%. And expect to beat a team like that, and they lost by three. So to me, it was just simply the free throw shooting, but they were right there, and I don't think a lot of people expected that once we found out AD wasn't going to be able to play earlier today.
Yeah, agreed, 100%. Yeah, Chris, you with us there on that one?
Yeah, I mean, just like Jas said, I mean, the free throw shooting, they were under 50% on free throws, I think is what they finished with. And, I can't hold this one against them personally, again, with no AD, no Kuz, and then we got this big game with the Bucks coming up. You could almost see something like this happening. I did feel like we were actually going to win the game at certain points, and I thought they played very well in certain spurts of the game. But, what you're going to do? You're not always going to win every game, obviously, and we're 24-4 now.
Yeah, and the away from Staples winning streak is broken. They were undefeated away from Staples Center, and now they have suffered a loss at the hands of the Indiana Pacers. But, the thought popped into my head. There was about 5 minutes left in the game, and I'm watching it, and I thought, gosh, win or lose, I'm pretty happy with this game. I mean, don't get me wrong. I want to see a win, but I'm happy with the way these guys played, with the way they went out there and competed. I know for me personally, and you guys were saying the same thing on our text chain there, this was going to be a tough one. And we knew it. We were kind of going into it going, uh-oh, no Davis. You've got no Kuzma. The Pacers have some size. This could be a really, really tough outing. But I thought the Lakers really stepped up and took on the challenge. Those guys all came out and played with fire and played with passion and played to win. They came up a little bit short, but it's not like they just mailed it in and said, oh, we're clearly not going to win this one. They came out there and did everything they could to win the game. I thought we might see a Lakers team that was looking ahead to the Bucks, and to their credit, they were not. They went out and played hard on every single possession, and I give them all the credit in the world for doing what they did tonight.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%, Trevor. You know what? I mean, I look at what the bench guys did. They combined for 53 points, the same bench mob that combined for 18 against Atlanta last game. So, obviously, those guys stepped it up. I think once they knew that no AD and, you still obviously have LeBron, which gives you a chance to win really any game you're playing in the NBA. But when we saw that, I mean, that was the first thing I had in my mind was, okay, the bench has got to be able to step up today. That 24 combined at halftime, 29 in the second half. Obviously, Dwight Howard at 10 and 10, so 10 of 10, pardon me, from the field. When I'm looking at it, I agree with you. I think this is almost like their first good loss of the season where you're like, okay, they did everything they could to win this one. The Pacers just made some extra plays. Obviously, the free throw line and the missed free throws were disappointing, of course, but still, to have a chance to win this game when you're missing two of your three best guys, it shows how much fight they have in this team as well.
Yeah, I mean, look, the free throws, that was really the game, right? They were 8 of 17 from the line, 47%, and then they were 25, 26% from three, 8 of 31 shooting. That's it. That's the game right there. A few missed shots, some missed free throws, and that's the difference. And here's the thing, and we were talking about this before we went on the air, when you don't have Anthony Davis, the margin of error that you have just goes down. And you can see that. You can't shoot that percentage from the free throw line and that percentage from three and expect to pick up a win when you don't have both LeBron and AD. It was unfortunate that it happened in this one the way it did. But again, it's not for lack of trying. It's not like these guys came out and just mailed in their performance as they looked ahead to the game against the Bucks.
Yeah, and I really like, you guys were talking about liking what we saw tonight of a lot of guys. I mean, specifically Dwight Howard, Alex Caruso, Avery Bradley. I liked what I saw a lot of these guys tonight in terms of on the defensive end, Dwight Howard cleaning up the mess and, going 10 for 10. It was, it wasn't necessarily a bad loss like you guys are saying. And like I was actually telling you guys earlier, this might be a good loss going into this big game against the Bucks on Thursday. It'll sharpen them up. Like they said, they don't want to lose two games in a row. Excuse my dog out there. She's apparently barking at somebody. But, they don't want to lose two games in a row. So we're going to go that much sharper into that big game that we have against the Bucks. We know that with our full squad, we can beat the Pacers. Let's put it that way.
So your dog is basically also upset about the Lakers loss and fired up, not pleased with that one. Look, like you guys said, I don't know if there's such thing as a good loss, but if there is, this was it, right? I mean, this was the game where you kind of felt like they were going to be maybe a little bit outmatched. It was going to be a tough one. They're on the road. They're in the middle of a long road trip. And they still almost came out with a win. Pretty impressive stuff overall. And then again, like you said, maybe it will sharpen them up for their game against the Bucks. That's kind of the glasses half full take there. So far, every time they've lost, they've responded with a long win streak. So we'll see. Who knows? Maybe this is the start of another win streak, and they're going to come take out the Bucks, the Nuggets, and the Clippers in a row, and then we'll all be really excited on Christmas Day.
Yeah, you know what? I mean, that's going to be a big one against Milwaukee. I don't know how much of a chance the Lakers will have without 100% Anthony Davis. I think that could get scary. But one thing they also got to sharpen up a little bit, man, the three-point shooting. They're 13 of 62 combined their last two games. That's like 20, just under 21%. So they got to find a way to start hitting their open jumpers. A lot of them have been open. It's not like they're taking a lot of contested threes other than maybe LeBron. But they need to kind of work on getting back to making those, because after today, I remember, Trevor, we were talking about it after one of the games. They were up to fifth in the league in three-point shooting. And then after Atlanta, it was so close they fell to 12th. I'm sure after today they're going to be a lot further down the rankings with that too. So for me, I think that's one thing they've got to look at and address, and how to make sure they're kind of getting and hitting more open threes out there.
Yeah, that's just it. Can you find a way to knock those down? And Frank Vogel, when they were struggling in the beginning of the season, kept saying that he wanted to make sure his team was turning down good shots in exchange for great shots. He wanted to find wide open looks. And so I think we'll see him go back to that mantra, try to get them to make the extra pass in order to get more open looks. But I did feel like they had some good open looks that just rimmed out. I mean, look, that final shot by Rondo was pretty open. And he almost knocked it down. And look, a lot of people are going to be questioning, why is Rondo taking that shot? He's actually been one of their better three-point shooters on the season. And he almost hit it. It just barely went in and out. So, you know, a fraction of an inch, and that thing hits bottom. So, can't be too disappointed there. You just got to hope that they do find a way to knock them down over this next coming week and a half.
Yeah, and you think, based on what we're seeing, I mean, we really, I know you were talking about the trade market being open now and everything. Mm-hmm. I wonder if there's almost – it would be nice to have somebody who's a consistent dead-eye shooter, because I feel like we have some good shooters, but they – almost all of them feel streaky to some extent. So I don't know exactly who's on the market or how we could match up, you know, make that kind of trade work, or if there is anybody, but we definitely need it. What do you think, Jazz?
I'm with you, man. I think that's one thing we've talked about. Again, and we're crying over spilled milk here, because the team's 24-4. You know what I mean? Let's not forget that. And then they played a hell of a game today with, like I've said, two out of their best three offensive players without AD and Kuz. But that's one thing that we've looked at and said, okay, not in the regular season. It did kind of bite them today, almost bit them against Atlanta. But you're worried about what's going to happen in April and May as we get into the playoffs. And so the way I'm looking at it on that is the fact that, yeah, if you can get into the buyout market or get somebody on the cheap, a good outside shooter, that's one thing they're going to have to address at some point. Because to me, Troy Daniels, obviously not doing what he was bought in to do, and Quinn Cook has been, you know, invisible the entire time, basically, other than one or two good games that he's had so far in terms of the outside shooting. What about you guys?
Well, yeah, I mean, look, here's the thing. If we said what was the one thing the Lakers addressed over the offseason, we would have said shooting, right? I mean, aside from landing Anthony Davis and a second star and all that, I mean, the one thing they addressed in terms of role players was shooting. Danny Green, Quinn Cook, Troy Daniels, all these guys that they brought in, they're supposed to all be able to knock down shots, but it just hasn't quite been happening, not at a level that you would like to see it. But, you know, Danny Green on the night can't complain. 2 of 4, 50% from three, that's totally fine. But it's the rest of the guys, the accumulation of them. 1 of 4 from Avery Bradley, 2 of 5 from Alex Caruso, obviously fine. 0 of 6 from LeBron, 1 of 4 from Dudley. When you add all those up, it starts to really take its toll on your 3-point percentage. I don't know if the solution is to go out there and hit the trade market and find somebody who's just a great shooter, like a JJ Redick type. That's a name that we saw pop up today as somebody that the Pelicans are still kind of reluctant to deal. But I feel like the shooting is on the roster. They just have to figure out a way to knock them down.
Yeah, I mean, and that's where maybe Frank Vogel can get – I mean, again, I don't want to sit here and act like, oh, you know, this is an awful performance. And, you know, obviously I've said this before. They've won 24 out of their first 28 games, so they're doing a lot, right? I just think maybe next time, too, if AD is not not going to be able to play in Milwaukee, and you don't have Kuz, maybe run a few more set pieces to try and get guys some more open looks. KCP's been pretty good from three-point land recently. Hopefully Danny Green starts to get going after this performance today. But I'm worried about it happening on a consistent basis from one of the guys outside of LeBron, AD, in terms of getting offensive production. You want to hope to either see somebody that be able to hit, especially the three-point line. That's what Danny Green was bought in for. So hopefully he can get that rolling now.
Yeah, hopefully they can figure out a way to get those guys to start knocking down shots. Chris, was there anybody who stood out to you today in this game? Anybody, a non-LeBron player that you thought really played pretty well? It sounds like somebody's tapping out Morse code on one of your mics, by the way, guys.
Sorry.
Where's Chris? Chris, let me guess. Were you typing out like Master Lock? Master Lock.
Yes. I think Dwight Howard stood out to me, honestly. I mean, he was doing a lot of damage in the paint, and really, I mean, he was 10 for 10. How many rebounds did he have? 6 rebounds, 2 blocks. I just really felt like it was a good game out of Dwight tonight, and he really stood out to me. In addition to, obviously, like I said before, Caruso and Bradley, they looked like they were all over the place defensively. I'd always see either Caruso or Bradley helping out defensively when they can, you know, trying to trap guys or anything like that. So those three guys tonight specifically.
Yeah, Chris, you know what? One of our colleagues from Lakers Nation, Corey Hansford, was tweeting out that he still can't believe that at this point in the season, he is cheering this loudly for Dwight Howard. 10 of 10 from the field tonight, 20 points, 6 boards, 2 blocks. This was like a throwback Orlando Magic Dwight Howard game. I mean, he was really impressive. He really stepped up. I'm still in disbelief. Chris, I know coming from your perspective, you probably can't believe that Dwight Howard is doing these things that he's doing either.
Oh, yeah. I mean, especially he's a babyface in L.A. now. And I know, right? You guys, we've talked about this before. Dwight Howard was a taboo topic out here. You did not talk about Dwight Howard. We did not like him. And now he's loved in the city, and he's doing it's great to see a redemption story like this play out in front of us. I mean, granted, we still need him to play big minutes later in the season. That's when it's really going to count. But it's nice to see him really embracing Los Angeles to this extent. And you know, to the point where he's even dyeing his braids purple.
That's
Chris,
right.
You know what? Chris, can I ask you something about that? So we saw the transformation with Dwight Howard's body, you know, throughout the summer in terms of he was bulkier, heavier, carrying a lot more muscle, a lot more lean now. How much work would he have to put into that? Would that be diet-based or kind of the exercises that he's doing in the gym in order to kind of shed that weight and get a little bit lighter? Because he looks so much quicker on his feet now than he did lethargic with, you know, Washington a bit last year, and as well as stopping Charlotte too.
Yeah, he looks like he probably is intaking a lot less calories, first of all, and then probably just doing a lot more aerobic activity than even weightlifting. I know that's been usually the case for me whenever I've had a couple points in my career where I dropped a significant amount of weight, being that 10, 15. I don't know if I've ever dropped 20 pounds, but, obviously, the thing is when you drop that amount of weight too, you feel so much lighter on your feet. So Dwight Howard probably feels like 5 years younger, just carrying around less weight on the basketball court. A lot of that muscle he had, it looked real good, and it would look great if he was like a wrestler, for instance. But, for an NBA court, I don't think it's necessary. I think he still has as much strength and brute force, even at a lighter weight, at least on a basketball court.
Yeah, well, go ahead, Jess.
I was going to say Chris has more muscle in his left bicep than me and Trevor do combined in our bodies. So, I mean, that's okay. We get it. We figure that out.
We went to the right guy for the question about musculature. hey, Jess, we've got a debate raging here in our chat with some people saying LeBron had a bad game. Others people saying, what are you talking about? LeBron did not have a bad game. Did LeBron James have a bad game tonight?
Well, I think if you watch the Pacers' defense, a lot of them were cracking down and basically plugging up the lane anytime he was trying to drive. He was 8 for 20 from the field, and you know, they're even on that last drive there against Miles Turner, where he pulled up for that three. He was almost doing that from a point of there was nothing available to him. He got to the paint a couple times and he pulled back out, and you know, Danny Green was open in the corner, but it was almost like those guys were staying home, they were helping out. To me, I mean, I don't think he had a great game offensively. I mean, you can never complain when a guy is 29-9. I mean, he was a dime and a rebound short of a triple double. But right. I just think that he had to deal with everybody keying on him today to try and stop him, and that's what the Pacers knew they had to do in order to get a win.
Yeah, I mean, look, I look at his stat line and I think 8 of 20 from the field. So if he makes one more shot, two more shots, and if he hits a couple of free throws, if he's 6 of 8, right? This is a win, and we're talking about what a great game LeBron had, right? Mm-hmm. That's how close it is, that razor's edge, where LeBron, you look at his stat line, you go 20 points, 9 boards, 9 assists, but he missed some free throws, and he missed a few shots, more maybe a few more than he normally would, and everybody points at him and goes, oh, clearly he didn't have a good game. Again, we're talking about a tiny, small margin of error there. And so I don't think it was a poor performance, but I thought some of the passes he threw tonight were ridiculous. Chris, there was that pass, that behind-the-back pass that he threw, I think it was to JaVale McGee. Oh, my God. That reminded me of Magic Johnson right there. I know you're a lifelong Laker fan, Chris. Were you having Magic flashbacks like I was?
Oh, yeah. Obviously, when you see LeBron is the closest thing we've ever seen to Magic Johnson. I remember the last game where did he do that between the legs to Dwight Howard. That was probably one of the dunks of the year. I mean, it's amazing to see. And, you know, the crazy thing about LeBron, too, is he's much more of a physical specimen than even Magic Johnson was. So, you know, it was a tough night for him, going 0-for-6 from the three, the 50% from the line. But, I mean, again, just when he's out there, we have the best shot. I mean, if LeBron goes down, I have so much less faith in our team winning. But even tonight, with AD and Kuz being down, knowing that we had LeBron on the lineup, I'm like, oh, we got a good shot to win this one.
Yeah, that's what I thought too. Like, you've got LeBron out there, you've got a great chance. Swaggy Fan from Periscope mentions the Dwight pass. Yeah, LeBron had multiple just highlight reel passes. The Dwight pass as well was another absolutely incredible one. Some people are saying not clutch LeBron and all that kind of stuff. I get it. Look, the 5 turnovers and all that, but still, you're nowhere close to winning this game without him. I didn't think his performance was all that bad. Yeah, he made some key errors, made some mistakes, but you clean up a few little things here and there, and the entire narrative flips. I'm saying it's not like it was a disaster game from him or anything like that. Food TV from YouTube. Jass, without AD, the Lakers are nothing. Do you agree with that, Jass? Is it, if you don't have Anthony Davis and LeBron, are the Lakers just dead in the water?
No, I still think that they would be a playoff team in the Western Conference and fighting for maybe the 7, maybe the 6 seed on if things went really well for them. I don't think they'd be dead in the water. That's like saying, well, if you take Kawhi Leonard off the LA Clippers, are they going to be any good? You take Giannis Antetokounmpo off the Milwaukee Bucks. Now, I don't think the Lakers are dead in the water. You still have LeBron James, and the way he's played this year and how he's been, the revenge season, Wash King, all the other hashtags he's putting out there, you know, he seems motivated and he seems ready. So, no, I don't think the Lakers would be dead in the water at all. They're still a playoff team without AD. Now, having AD, obviously that propels them to championship contender status. But, I mean, yeah, they would definitely be a death blow almost if you didn't have him in terms of winning a championship. But they're still a pretty good and you know, top 15 team in the NBA. What do you guys think?
Oh, absolutely. I agree. They'd be definitely top 15. I look at the way they got up for this game. And you can't expect that on a nightly. If they just didn't have Anthony Davis, you couldn't expect this type of performance on a nightly basis. The way Caruso stepped up, Dwight Howard going for 20, all that. They clearly all knew, had it in their heads. We need to step up to make up for AD. But still, I think they'd be a top 15 team even without him. And that's and then with him, they're a top two team, top three team, whatever. Right, Chris?
Yeah, I like this team. They play well together, and it doesn't. You know, AD is great. Obviously, we love AD, and he's going to be our future for a long time, but I like this team comprised of everybody. I like Danny Green. I like Dwight Howard. I like Caruso. I mean, they are not trash by any means.
All right, guys, I've got a real serious question for you here coming from Roman Reyes from YouTube. Pineapple on pizza, Trevor, with a question mark. I'm going to let you guys weigh in first. Jazz, does pineapple belong on pizza? And this is serious, serious stuff here.
Yes, all day, twice on Sunday. I say yes to pineapple pizza. Ham and pineapple, you can never go wrong with it.
I think I know where you're going with this, Trevor. I originally was with you, and I was a no pineapple on pizza guy, although I did have some pineapple on pizza when I was in Alaska, and it was freaking beautiful. It was so good. So I have to say pineapple does work in some cases on pizza.
Okay, I'm gonna be the guy on the island. I'm gonna say no. Pineapple does not belong on pizza, and I will tell you why. Here's the problem: people who order pineapple on pizza are damn selfish. Okay, because you know what happens? You get people like me who don't like pineapple on pizza. You can't just order it on half, because what happens is the pineapple juice like seeps in to the rest of the pizza. You get the pineapple taste. If you're that guy that has the half of the pizza that has no pineapple, it still tastes like pineapple. You have to order a whole extra pizza just to get the pineapple away from it. Keep your pineapple off of pizza, people. Come on.
Oh, wow.
That's a very good point, Trev.
Yeah, yeah. That's, he's more upset about pineapple on pizza than he is Lakers losing today. I don't know what's going into him right now.
I know, my goodness.
I told you this is serious stuff here, guys.
That's fair, yeah. Well, now we know how serious it is. Man, sorry, it's our bad dude.
You are right about it infecting the whole pizza, though. It really does. Happens. And I've had this issue with my girlfriend before.
It is an issue. Jawan Williams from Facebook says, same problem, different game, turnovers and free throws. The turnovers, you know what? It started off pretty sloppy, but then at the end of the game, they had 14 turnovers. Like, that's not great, but that's not awful either. Like, I'm okay with 14 turnovers in a game where you're missing two of your better players. I didn't have an issue with that. So, yeah, it was ugly at some points. But then you go and you dig in a little bit deeper and you look at, you know, the points off turnovers, both teams were tied at 13 points off turnovers. The Lakers only gave up 8 fast break points, and that's been a problem with them in the past. I was actually okay with the pace they played at and with the turnovers tonight. I thought they were just fine.
Yeah, I thought they looked good. I thought they looked good as well. They had that ugly stretch in the beginning of the third quarter. Do you guys remember coming out after halftime? And I was taking notes on that. They had scored 11 points in the first 8 minutes, 8.5 minutes of the third quarter, and then scored they scored 13 more in the last 3.5 minutes. So they started to get things rolling, and a lot of those turnovers were coming in that time. I don't know the exact amount off the top of my head, but I think there was 4 or 5 turnovers just in that little stretch of the game for the Lakers themselves. So, I mean, again, I'm not going to look at this and say, oh, this was an awful loss. I mean, that Mavericks loss, they looked terrible. The loss to the Raptors at home, they looked terrible. Today, they look great. They were playing shorthanded. Mm-hmm. I thought they did a lot of things right. Did they shoot themselves in the foot? The good part is, playing without 2 or 3 best players, you still had a chance to win against the 18-9 team on their home court. And it was 2 or 3 plays here and there. LeBron and Dwight Howard on the free throws. One more 3-pointer changes the narrative of this game. And if LeBron ends up scoring 24 points and hits a 3 and extra 2 free throws, we're talking about a superhuman effort by LeBron James, even though he would have ended with 25 points, but led his team to a win without Anthony Davis and Kyle Kuzma.
Exactly. It's amazing how much the narrative can change with one little thing here and there, and it can completely turn things around, changes the perception of everything. It's just the way of the world. It's the way it is. Andres Montoya says, Trevor, I was going to send you a case of pineapples. Keep them, Andres. You hang on to those pineapples. Send me a case of Uptime Energy drink instead, Andres. How about that? Greg V said, do you guys know if AD is playing against the Milwaukee Bucks? I would hope so, being that he was a game time call, but nothing official at this point. I haven't been checking Twitter there to see if anybody mentioned anything after the game just yet. But I don't know if... Oh, we're going to talk about this. Something just popped up we need to discuss here. But I don't know. I would say it looks likely, but it kind of depends on how it responds from you. Chris, you've dealt with injuries like this. When you turn your ankle, if you feel like you're pretty close to being able to play, being able to compete, and then it's a few days later, chances are probably good that you're going to be able to get the next one, right?
Yeah, and I think he'll be playing in the next one. And I think that part of him sitting out might be the fact that we're playing the Bucks in a couple of days. You know, maybe he just wanted to get that extra bit of heel time. They know how important that game is. I mean, right now we know who stands at the top of the whole NBA, you know, between the Bucks, Clippers, Lakers pretty much, right? And I don't know, I guess the Mavs are probably up there somewhere. But, you know, I think he's going to play, and I think it's going to be a fascinating matchup to watch on Thursday because of some of the things we've brought up, you know, in terms of, I think, you know, the Bucks are 3-point shooters, just a bunch of snipers right there, right? And we don't have shooting like that. So, I don't know. I think we'll have AD. I'm crossing my fingers. I'm hoping we have him. So, we'll see.
Yeah, absolutely.
Hey, Trevor, I got a question for you. Yeah. Who do you put on Giannis on Thursday?
AD. I put him on there. Yeah, I know that Giannis might be a little bit quicker, but AD's got the length to deal with him. I mean, I'm not going to, like, LeBron can spend some stretches on him, but he's too big to put Danny Green on him, and he's too fast to put Dwight Howard or JaVale on him. So, and realistically, it's going to be a team defensive effort on him, but I think you've got to go AD getting the majority of the minutes, and that may tire him out. But again, it's kind of what you have to do. You don't really have much of a choice there.
But one more question. If AD's out, though, who do you go with as a backup? You start LeBron on him right away, or do you kind of go with, I was going to say KCP. I don't think that's going to be good for anyone.
like Kawhi Leonard ate up KCP. That's just mean to KCP, man.
Oh, my God.
Do you sacrifice Jared Dudley to him?
Oh, come on, man.
I mean,
Jared Dudley.
You could see if Jared Dudley can get in a fight with him. Maybe that would work.
Just get a couple of technicals and ejected. That'd probably be the best defense right now. Just sit there and just go in his face, slap him a couple times, and see what he does. Right.
That's probably the way to do it. By the way, guys, we've been talking about this every week about how the Lakers, the teams are going to get up to play the Lakers. Malcolm Brogdon called this game the biggest win of the Pacers season in the post game. Which, yes, that validates everything we've been saying. And I'm not trying to say that as like, oh, the Lakers are so great and you know, every other team's is so fired up to play them because the Lakers are so much better and all. No, they understand there's going to be more eyeballs on this game than anybody else. I'm not trying to, you know, look down on any other teams and say, oh, it's only the Lakers that fans tune in for. But teams know, players know that they're going to have a lot of eyeballs on them when they're playing the Lakers. So it is. And the Pacers, to their credit, they played like this was their biggest game of the season. And they did what they needed to do to win. So credit to them. I actually really liked this Pacers team, seeing them play, the way they work together, the way they cut off the ball. That's a team that I'm definitely going to be trying to watch more of, just kind of in spare time and stuff.
Well, you know, and that's interesting that you're saying that, because I would like to ask Chris that as well. You know, when you're playing in these games, like we're talking about how the Lakers' opponents are always like, yo, the Lakers are coming to town. The ticket prices on the secondary market mm-hmm. always higher because it's an in-demand ticket. So for you, Chris, like if you're wrestling and, you know, your time in the WWE, if you were going against, you know, a guy like John Cena or the big guys, is there a different kind of, like, you know, excitement and nervousness, or is it like intensity that you have compared to if you were going against the Brooklyn Brawler or something along those lines?
Oh yeah, definitely. Just because, I mean, it would be a little different for a wrestling show because the show is comprised of many matches and one game is considered a game. But you know, there's definitely another level you bring it to, especially if, you know, let's just say you're the main event of a show, you know that, and you're on with a John Cena or a Shawn Michaels or somebody, you know that you have to close the show. You know, you're out there with one of the best in the business. So, you know, to go back to what you're saying, you know, I'm sure that when the Lakers go up against these teams that we're talking about, they're going into these games with that type of mindset. They know it's not just another Tuesday in Indianapolis. This is, well, you know, granted, it is Milwaukee, but, you know, it's Milwaukee and they're the Bucks and they're a top team in the league. So they're going to approach it like that, whether they say it or not. You know, they're going to probably say they're going to approach it just like any other game. But, you know, you definitely approach those moments like much more. And you sometimes are on autopilot in some of the situations, like, you know, even tonight, you know, at some points they might have been on autopilot and then they were able to pick it up. And, you know, you get yourself up to another level for those big games or those big matchups.
Yeah, that's the case. That's the case across all sports. When there's that big contest, you know that it's going to be, whether it's LA Galaxy versus LAFC, whether it's Dodgers versus Giants, whatever, Yankees, Red Sox, right? Teams get up for those big, big matchups, right? 49ers versus Falcons, right? Those are the big ones that teams...
I was going to do something that I probably shouldn't have done on the camera, so it's a good thing I did.
Sorry, Jess. Oh, sorry, Jess.
Cheap shot, man. That's all right. I'll take it. They lost. They lost to a 4-9 team at home. That's okay. I'll take it.
Yeah, that is what happened. But hey, the Niners look great, by the way, and their defense has gotten me to the championship round of my one of my fantasy leagues. So hoping that will hopefully they'll stay strong.
At least one of us got there, right? Congratulations on doing that, because I was in two and I was terrible in both. So yeah,
I'm in the championship in 2 out of 5, so I'm feeling pretty good about that. At this
point, 40%.
40%. I'll take it. If only the Lakers could shoot 40% from three.
Yeah, that's true.
Take
that in a heartbeat as well, right?
Hey, I've got a good take here from Albert Jones from Facebook. A Laker loss every 2.5 weeks is doable. Smiley face.
Yeah.
Right? Right? Like, look at the big picture, guys. They've won so many games. They're 24-4. Think about it. It was just a few years ago. They won 17 games total all season.
Yeah.
They won 17 games. They're 24-4. Chris on Periscope, I've got Sims MMA says Chris the Clicker Masters.
Yeah, I was hearing that again too, right?
That's my new gimmick
over there, right?
That's his new thing. He's drawing heat by clicking.
Yeah, that's right. There you go, right? Chris the Clicker Masters. That's what we're gonna go with from now on.
Hey, a lot of people right now are chiming in saying that they are concerned about LeBron's free throw shooting and that it's becoming a bigger problem. They're worried about it, particularly in crunch time situations. Are you guys worried at all about LeBron's free throw shooting, or do you think he's going to make them when they count?
I mean, we saw we saw LeBron miss a couple of free throws, but and then, you know, it was getting to me. But then a couple minutes later there at the end of the fourth quarter, we saw him hit his last two. So I don't know if it's necessarily a concern. I mean, it is the one part of his game that looks like it's the one weak part of his game right now. But I don't know. I have faith. It seems like he every season he usually turns this around at some point and, you know, ends up faring at a fairly decent percentage. What do you think, Jazz?
You know what? That's been an issue since he came here. It was 66% last year, 68% this year. He's a career 73% shooter. I don't know. I mean, that's something that I wish that you can ask. And I know from my years that even playing college basketball, it some guys can hit them consistently and just some guys don't. It's not a matter of practice. It's not a matter of anything else. It's just, you know what I mean? It's not as easy as it looks. Should he be hitting more at his level? Absolutely. But I think LeBron is what he is at this point. I've also seen him hit clutch shots, free throws a lot of times in his career, and I've seen him miss a few times. So I think that's what you're getting with him. He's not Steph Curry. He's not Klay Thompson. He's not Steve Nash, who you guaranteed are going to shoot 90% year in and year out. This is what he is from the free throw line, and he's been the whole time he's been in the NBA.
Here's the thing that I think we see with free throws, and this is why people freak out so much about them. It's because you can go in your driveway and shoot free throws, right? Like LeBron, yes. LeBron can drive down the lane, fly into the air, and then throw a behind-the-back pass on the money and lead to a ferocious slam. Most people can't do that, right? So yeah. If he blows that, if something happens and you know, the ball slams off somebody's chest and goes out of bounds or whatever, you know, people are a little bit more forgiving of plays like that, whereas missed free throws, we're, like, expecting them to make it. It's almost like the kicker missing in football, right? It's that type of thing where you just expect them to make all of them, not understanding that it's actually really difficult to do. I mean, look at Dwight Howard, who's a terrible free throw shooter, and there's that infamous board that the Lakers had when they first had him, where they were keeping track of everybody's free throws. In practice, he was, like, an 82% free throw shooter. It's such a different environment in the games. It's a mental thing, and it's really, really difficult to be able to hit those when you've got the entire arena there, you've been playing a game, you're tired, all of those things matter. And yes, LeBron's a professional. Yes, he should be able to knock him down, but I'm saying it's not just a gimme that he's going to make all of them. He's 68% from the line for the season. I'd love to hit for him to be up in the low 70s, but I think if anything, I'd like to see him shooting more of them. He's at a career low 5.4 free throws per game. I'd like to see him get some more free throws off and get some more reps in up there at the line, because I'm hoping that as the season goes on, he'll develop a little bit more of a rhythm. That's so key to being able to knock those down. It's just getting that rhythm, getting the reps, getting up there and hitting them.
Yeah, I agree with you. You know, and I think a little bit of a byproduct of him getting less free throws this season has been the fact that Anthony Davis has been close to the hoop and kind of, I don't want to say clogging the lane, but is taking up a lot of the real estate, you know, in the paint and near the hoop. But because I think LeBron's been very aggressive this year. I mean, he's had some killer takes where he's driving down the lane, beats his guy off the top, and throws it down. So I don't know if it's a case of aggression or anything like that, but I do agree with you. I think that he needs to get to a moment where he's shooting 14, 15, 16 free throws a game for a couple of times, you know, two, three times in a row, or two, three times out of a 5-6 game stretch to get that rhythm going. But I'm going to stick with that. I just think he's roughly a 70% free throw shooter. That's going to go down a little bit at the end of games, especially if you're tired, you don't have the legs, and he's turning 35, in a couple of weeks here. So, you know, it's not going to get easier for him on that front. Again, I just think that it's not, like you're saying, it's not as easy as people think it is that, well, if you're shooting a free throw, you should shoot 100% from there. It's like, no, I mean, there's a lot of variables to it, but LeBron is what he is. And this was a concern when he was in Miami as well, that he's not a great free throw shooter, and he's not a clutch free throw shooter. As Chris mentioned, he did hit a couple at the end there that got the team back in it. But I just think that's what he is at this time from the free throw line.
Yeah, and you'll take it, right? I mean, look, if that's his one flaw, okay, he's one of the all-time greats, right? I mean, if he misses some free throws every now and then, yeah, you'd love to see him knock him down, but you'll take that. You'll take LeBron missing a few free throws, because he's going to give you 20-plus points plus 9 boards and 8 assists, or 8 boards and 9 assists, or however you want to look at it, right? He's going to do all those other things, so you just kind of got to roll with it. I'm not going to nitpick too much over a few missed free throws.
Yeah, us as fans, we can tend to be unreasonable sometimes. Yeah, he's not going to hit every single free throw he hits. And, you know, like you said, he does basically everything else. So, of course, everybody's going to have an Achilles heel, so to speak. So, and just for LeBron, it happens to be free throws. But it's not to the extent of a, Shaquille O'Neal or Dwight Howard or anything, where they're going to hack LeBron. But, you know, it can be a concern in the clutch for us, definitely. Mm-hmm.
So before we move on and just get to the Milwaukee Bucks game, there's one thing I want to address here, and that's I've got on YouTube, JRL says Vogel is overrated. And then a few comments down, Free Form Rico says Vogel coach of the year. Differing opinions, clearly, right? I don't look at this game and think this was Vogel. Vogel blew it. I actually thought some things stood out that he did really well. Jas, what was your take on Vogel, what we've seen from him so far, and what we saw from him in this game?
I just want to start off by saying that those two comments encapsulate today's world on the internet so yes. much. You know what I mean? One side is one argument, the other has the other. But I love the job Frank Vogel has done. I think he's been very flexible and adapts to what the situation is. And I mean, what? They lost to a team that's now 19-9 on the road in a close three-point game. I don't know what else he could have done differently strategically. I like the fact that he put Jared Dudley in the lineup because it kind of gave the other guys more continuity mm-hmm. that played with each other a little bit on the second unit. I like the fact that he still kept LeBron at 35 minutes, even though he could have given him four or five more just because of the fact they didn't have AD. I don't have no complaints about Frank Vogel so far. I think he's been great. You know, and you're coaching a team that's 24-4. You've obviously hit a lot of the right buttons at the same time as people calling him out. You got to point to their record as well.
Yeah, 100% agreed. And you know what, Chris, one of the things I think Vogel is so good at, by the way, the Lakers lost 105 to 102 in this one, super close one. I think he's been really good at improvising and kind of just reading what's happening in the game and reacting. You do that a ton in your wrestling matches. You have to read and react to everything that's going on, and sometimes you have to improvise. How difficult is that in the moment when you've got the entire crowd watching you and waiting for your reaction and how you're going to respond to a situation?
Well, it can be difficult, but usually when you're in those type of situations, your adrenaline is so high and you're not really thinking as much as just reacting. It's almost instantaneous. So I think a lot of these guys, when they get out on the court, it's just that, you know, you've heard them talk about game speed and everything. Mm-hmm. I think things move so fast, you don't have a lot of time. It's just like you said, it's read and reacting, and at a certain point, you don't even really realize almost that the crowd's there because you're so focused on the job at hand and what you're doing and execution and everything like that.
Have you found yourself in a moment where, like, you had to make a decision where something went wrong and you had to make a choice on what to do, and it was a moment that you had to process something really quickly? Because that's something I think Vogel's been really good at. Has been, you know, when he can't just read and react to something, when something shifts in the game, coming up with an alternative plan, what's that like?
Oh, yeah. Well, I've had certain matches where I was slated to be the bad guy, and for mm-hmm. whatever reason, the crowd was reacting to me. Like, sometimes Perfect. The crowd doesn't exactly react as you want them to, and I've had matches where you actually switch roles and you go from either the bad guy to the good guy or the good guy to the bad guy. And you make that decision on the fly based on, like, taking the temperature of the crowd and just, you know, it doesn't mean you have to give the audience what you want. And again, I know I'm talking about wrestling here, but, you know, it does, you know, you do got to make these judgment calls. And, you know, that's kind of like what I think you're alluding to with Frank Vogel, is he's having to make these kind of decisions on the fly. And we didn't see a lot of this out of Luke Walton last year. Again, I know we've all talked about that a lot. So I really respect what we've seen out of Frank Vogel and the decisions he's made. And again, this was our third choice coach, and he's doing this awesome.
Yeah, he absolutely is. And I think you hit the nail on the head there, Chris. It's not an easy thing to do. And sometimes you do have to kind of flip the script. Today in the game, the Lakers had to go with these four guard lineups where they had, you know, Caruso and Danny Green and KCP and Rondo out there, along with, say, a Dwight Howard. And at first, they were definitely slowing the ball down and doing everything they could to try to limit the amount of offensive possessions, which is exactly what you should do when you're up and your team relies on LeBron James. And I thought they were handling that pretty well. And then in the third quarter, Frank Vogel said, okay, go. When the Lakers were down and he knew they needed scoring, it's time to throw caution to the wind, let them go out there and attack, even if it creates more offensive possessions, because you can't just sit on the game. You can't try to slow it down too much. You might as well see if you can generate some offense. And so he read the game perfectly in those moments, and it was a very quickly changing game, and he completely shifted his strategy with his small ball units. So just another example. It seems like every game there's an example of a situation where Vogel reads what's happening and he responds in the right way, and it works out well for the Lakers. And of course, you know, they don't pick up the win today, but the decision making from Vogel I thought was really, really good. And that's something that I've been really excited about from him this season. And like you said, part of that is in contrast to what we saw from Luke Walton, but part of this is just Frank Vogel is really good at his job. I think we can kind of agree on that at this point.
Yeah, you're 100% right, man. I mean, again, and he had to deal with a lot of the question marks that people had about, okay, they wanted Ty Lue. Mm-hmm. That, you know, they didn't want Frank Vogel. Then it was, oh, the Lakers hired Jason Kidd almost as like a backup plan, that if something goes wrong with Frank Vogel early in the season, Jason Kidd's going to be the you know, the whispers about Jason Kidd becoming the coach are going to get louder and louder. And what we've seen now is that nobody's questioning the coach. I think that was the first time I've ever heard. I don't know if anybody else has in the comments. I mean, Trevor, because you see them, but
yeah.
I haven't heard one peep of criticism about Frank Vogel from media members, the other players, anybody else. I think he's been a great addition to the team. And let's be honest, I'm going to say what it is. LeBron probably does a lot of the coaching as well, in terms of trying to figure things out in terms of offensively and where he's comfortable with how things go. But at the same time, you got to manage the rotation. You got to manage kind of the game flow, because that's what basketball is. You can't just say, well, we're going to run a 2-3 zone the entire time, because if the team's killing it, you're obviously going to have to switch out of it. You have to adapt to what's happening on the fly. And I think that has been his biggest strength this season. Whereas with Luke Walton last year, a lot of it was based off of, well, this is my game plan and this is what I think is going to work. So the guys are going to run it come hell or high water.
Right, yeah, that's what we've been talking about this season, is just that adaptability compared to what they had last season. And you know what, you mentioned LeBron James kind of coaching things. That's always been the criticism, that LeBron is really the GM. Yep. LeBron is really the coach. It's Team LeBron. We're doing whatever he says. But I look at that, and I look at another strength for Vogel, right? He has managed to interact with LeBron James, not allow LeBron to overpower him. I think he has LeBron's respect. And I look at the way he relates to his assistant coaches, the way he brings in the opinions of LeBron, of we've seen him bring in KCP, we've seen him bring in Rondo, all these other voices. He's not afraid to let go of the rope a little bit and create that buy-in from the team and say, hey, look, we're all part of this. This isn't just, this is what we're doing. Everybody do what I say because I'm the coach. And I think it's a very, very fine line to walk, to be able to do that and still keep that respect and still keep that control. But he's done a tremendous job at that.
Yeah. I mean, totally agree. This has been he's just done a hell of a job coaching us. We're lucky to have him.
So let's get into the Milwaukee Bucks game. Chris, a lot of people have said this is the game that is going to really be a test for the Lakers. If they're not talking about the Clippers game just yet, they're talking about this game against the Milwaukee Bucks. What are we hoping to see out of this one heading into Milwaukee, knowing that hopefully AD is going to be coming off injury, hopefully Kuzma is going to be coming back? What are your thoughts on this matchup?
Well, my thoughts on this matchup are, I mean, this is a potential finals matchup. This is the best team in the East, and we've got the Greek freak, Giannis, over there, and it will be such an interesting matchup. I mean, it's like almost the headline of a WrestleMania, Giannis versus AD. Think about it. That would put asses in seats, wouldn't it?
Well, it's Hogan versus Savage all over again here, right?
Yeah. Well, and I also, again, to bring it up, we were talking about the three-point shooting of the Lakers tonight. Yeah. You know, the Bucks especially kind of concern me, because from the best of my knowledge, again, this is Giannis surrounded by a bunch of three-point shooters. So we might get stuck in a battle in this next game where they're hitting threes and we're hitting twos, and then the numbers are just not going to add out in the end. So, you know, it's going to be an interesting matchup.
Jazz, same thing. You worried about three-point shooting from the Bucks?
I'm worried about the health of Anthony Davis, because I think that if Anthony Davis doesn't play in this game, it's going to take a 45, 15, and 13 game from LeBron in order for them to even have a chance at winning. The Milwaukee Bucks are awesome. They are a juggernaut. And without an healthy AD, I think the Lakers, like Chris mentioned, they're going to have a hard time just keeping up on the scoreboard more than anything else, and that just has to do with firepower. But if AD is healthy, I'd like to see the Lakers try and slow the game down a little bit more, grind him out as much as they can inside, use your advantage with AD, and then get Dwight Howard, JaVale McGee to get some of those putbacks and those backdoor cut kind of dunks where they're feeding off of the penetration and getting lobbed. So to me, I want to look at the Lakers trying to not get into a track meet with these guys, slow it down and try and beat them with the advantage that you have, which might be inside with Anthony Davis.
Agreed. Yeah, you definitely have to try to do that. I'm really curious to see how they handle Brook Lopez, who's going to be trying to pull the Lakers' bigs away from the basket. We saw today that can be an issue when you had Miles Turner pulling Dwight Howard and pulling JaVale McGee away from the basket. That can be tough because that's not something that they want to do. And the Lakers kind of just lived with Miles Turner shooting some threes, and he made a few of them. So going to be interesting to see how they handle that. But yeah, it is going to come down to the Lakers' interior game. Can you beat up the Bucks on the inside? Which so far teams haven't really been able to, because Brook Lopez has been pretty good protecting the rim. But can you take advantage of the size difference that you're going to have in there, or will the Bucks kind of continue to do what they do, and will they continue to hit threes and still protect the rim? The Bucks are the top team in terms of net rating. They have a net rating of 12.4, which is ridiculous. The Lakers' net rating is second at 8.7. They are first in the NBA in defensive rating and second in the NBA in offensive rating. So they have a really good offense, a really good defense. This is just a very good team that's really firing on all cylinders. As of right now, they are fourth in the NBA in three-pointers made. They are, so they're shooting a ton of them, but they are actually 13th in three-point percentage at the moment. So maybe you can get them to miss some shots. But ultimately, I think this game's going to come down to defense. Can you get the Bucks to miss enough shots to get out in transition and score on them and not have to deal with their half-court defense? And they're going to be doing the same thing the other way. Can they get stops and then run on the Lakers and get easier looks without having to deal with the Lakers' half-court defense? Both teams are great defensively. Going to come down to whichever team. Honestly, we say it's a make-or-miss league, and maybe that's a little bit of a cop-out, but it's going to come down to whichever team can get stops and force misses from their opponent. And that's pretty much going to determine the narrative behind this game.
Yeah, that's why I'm hoping we see a fully healthy, I mean, he's not going to be fully healthy 100%, but as close to 100% Anthony Davis as you can, because you only get this matchup twice a year, right?
Yeah.
Both teams are 24-4. Just put your gloves on, duke it out, and let's see the best team is going to win. But I agree with you in the sense that it's going to be key for the Lakers to control the pace of the game, though.
Yeah.
I do think that's going to be huge for them, because if you're getting into a game that's going to hit the 115-120 mark, I don't think the Lakers are going to have a chance at winning that. I think if it's in the low hundreds like it was today, or even, the high 90s probably not going to happen because these teams are so good. But I think the Lakers got to limit the possessions and try and take advantage of what they have with LeBron and Anthony Davis and use the pick and roll a lot more. You know what I mean? Because, who are you going to put? If you go Giannis on AD, or you go Giannis on LeBron, I mean, I don't know if they'll do that much, but expose the other guy, whoever's guarding one of your big two. And I think it's going to be up to those two guys to carry the Lakers to a win in Milwaukee.
Yeah, agreed. That's what they're going to have to do. They're going to have to unleash that pick and roll, because that's going to be a pretty good scoring option for them. So, Chris, there's a comment here that says Mavs just beat them, from coming in from YouTube. What do you think? The fact that the Bucks just lost to the Mavs, does that help the Lakers or hurt the Lakers in terms of the mentality of the Bucks coming into this game?
Well, I know the Mavs have... don't they have their main players down? Doncic is down. So I mean, if anything, I guess both teams are going to come into Thursday pretty fired up for a
right.
W. So if anything, that loss probably hurts them, because now the Bucks are really going to want to win this game, seeing as that they lost against the Mavs without Luka, which is probably actually, I don't want to say it's embarrassing, because I know the Mavs are still a good team, but whenever you lose to a team and their top players down, that's not necessarily a good thing. So, specifically for the Lakers, it can't be good for them to lose, because then I think we're going to get the best of the Bucks. But remember, the Lakers, we don't lose two games in a row. So I know they're going into this game, ultra-focused.
Yeah, I kind of wonder if Milwaukee was looking ahead to the Lakers game a little bit against the Mavs. Because that's, like, the Mavs kind of took advantage of the Lakers in that way. And I'm wondering if that's part of what happened there with the Bucks. Were they just looking ahead, because that's their next game on the schedule is the Lakers? Maybe they were looking ahead to this big matchup because it's the one that's got all the hype behind it. It's the one that's going to have all the eyeballs on them. So I wonder if the Mavs just happened to catch the Bucks at the right time.
Yeah, I'd go with that too. I mean, it is, and it's almost like this game. If Anthony Davis plays this game, the Lakers probably easily win. But we would talk that a little bit about that on Sunday, Trevor, after the Atlanta game. That okay, the Lakers played pretty damn ugly. They didn't have a lot going for them, and they looked like they were just kind of sleepwalking out there, and maybe looking ahead a little bit too much. And I think that's what happened with the Bucks. But again, I've said this before: the Mavericks are not a team to sneeze at. Like you said, I mean, they can fill it up and hit 23s on you any night, which is going to keep most teams in the game in the NBA.
Yeah, that's just it. The Mavs are a good team, even without Doncic. Sometimes teams step up, right? Like the game after they lose a star, you see these random games where you go, oh, okay, well, they're clearly not that good anymore. And then you have all the role players step up, and they play pretty well. I think the Lakers kind of had that effect a little bit tonight. But over the long term, the Mavs are going to hurt from losing Doncic. But in that immediate reaction, you see guys step up and do things and play well. So you can have that kind of effect. And I think that may have been part of what was at play here. Plus the Bucks maybe looking ahead regardless, right? Regardless of whether or not the Bucks lost, though, I think they were going to give – whatever their best is, they're going to throw it at the Lakers, and I think the Lakers are going to throw their best at the Bucks.
Yeah, it's going to be a hell of a matchup. I mean, both teams losing tonight, and then going into that game, I mean, I think everybody was – they're probably everybody was just overlooking tonight's opponents, looking at Thursday's game, you know?
Yeah, I think that may have been part of the equation here. All right, guys, let's wrap things up there. Final thoughts. Final thoughts. Chris, why don't we go to you first? What are your final thoughts from tonight? And if you had a player of the game, who would you give that to?
Player of the game, I guess probably Dwight Howard. I just saw a lot of good activity out of him tonight, and it was good to see. And final thoughts is, again, I think even without AD, we have a great team. And, you know, they fell short tonight, but you can understand. No AD, no Kuz. Indianapolis on a Tuesday. They got this huge game Thursday. I was disappointed in the moment when we lost, as we were all together. But, you know, about 10 seconds later, I let it wash off or brush it off my shoulder, and we just got to look forward.
Jazz?
I'm going to say that Chris was underplaying it, that he was a lot more than disappointed. If you heard how loud he yelled at me, the trucker had to hear him into our earphones.
But, that is true.
I agree. You know what? They played. I think they played their hearts out. They played really well. It was a matter of one or two plays here, free throw here or there, three-pointer here or there. Missing two of your top three guys, I think this is a hell of an effort, and they know they can play with teams even if they're not fully loaded. So to me, it was a good loss and the first one of the season that I can say that.
And player of the game?
I'm just trying to be a jackass if I don't say Dwight Howard. Dwight Howard played awesome. They needed somebody else to step up other than LeBron. He had 20 points. Six rebounds was a beast down there, so I'd go with Dwight all day.
Yep, I'm going to agree with you guys there. I think there's no question. Maybe it was an easy question, but 20 points, 10 of 10 from the field. Can't argue that throwback game for Dwight. Hopefully there's more where that came from coming up on Thursday. Big game against the Milwaukee Bucks. Can't wait to see how the Lakers respond. Can they bounce back from this loss, or will the Bucks bounce back from their own loss to the Dallas Mavericks? So great one to check out. Make sure you guys come join us. We'll be right here after the game, breaking everything down. That's Thursday evening when the Lakers take on the Milwaukee Bucks. I want to take a moment to thank everybody who jumped in here, all of you coming in from Facebook Live, from YouTube, from Periscope. Appreciate all the questions, all the comments, all the back and forth, all the Vogel is awesome, Vogel is terrible, LeBron doesn't shoot free throws, LeBron's the best. You guys are amazing. I love watching everybody go back and forth in all the comment section here. So again, appreciate everybody hopping in and joining us right here on the Lakers Nation postgame show. My name's Trevor Lane. If you want to follow me, you can find me on Twitter at Trevor_Lane. Find Jazz at JazzKang21, and you can find Chris at Chris Adonis. Make sure you guys are following the Lakers Nation accounts at Lakers Nation on Twitter and Facebook, at Lakers Nation Official on Instagram, and don't forget, guys, hit subscribe on the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. All right, guys, till next time, Lakers versus Bucks coming up. I can't wait. Let's see what this team is made of. Till then, see ya.